Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the African Heritage Cooking for the Holidays. My name is Marlon Solomon. I am the president and founder of the Afro-American Culture Initiative, a Boston-based nonprofit organization. Our mission is to build cultural bridges in the African diaspora through education, technology, and travel. We want to welcome everybody in here today. We're going to have a lovely evening. We're going to learn to cook some of the African heritage diet and talk about healthy eating, healthy diet, the culture of it. Our organization is an African diaspora cultural education provider. So we make educational content like this. We do web hosting. We are putting together an online school. We're 501c3, so of course we appreciate any of your contributions. And we are partnering today with our cultural nutrition partner, Sarah Anderson. Hi, she's from Oldways. And they are a phenomenal nonprofit here in Boston. As soon as I saw them, I fell in love with them immediately. They capture the exact essence of what it is we teach here in regards to African diaspora cultural education. African diaspora cultural education is really kind of that's Afro-American culture. It's kind of like a mixture of all the different African descended cultures that exist here in America. And what we do is that, you know, we recognize that there are different levels of culture depending on when you got over here, to be, frankly honest, as a Black person. So we recognize that all of our cultures, that we have something to share amongst ourselves. And this organization is a celebration of that. What Oldways does is they really bring out the practical side of it and through food. And I've never seen it explained better, but I'm not going to go too much. Sarah, you want to say hi and introduce yourself for a little bit?
Hi, I'm the curriculum coordinator for A Taste of African Heritage and Latin American Heritage. I'll be presenting later on about our program that we offer at Oldways. So excited to be here with you all today.
Thank you, Sarah. And one thing we have going on today, we have an Uber Eats voucher. So what I'm going to do is that we have everybody's email that was in here, and we're going to do it and towards the end, and it's a randomizer thing. So I'll try to do that during the end, and we'll find our person who will get the Uber Eats voucher. And we want you to use it at one of the local restaurants here in Boston, one of the cultural cuisine restaurants. And we have a resource page that we're going to share in the chat, and that resource has every video, every link, a lot of other extra stuff, and links to Uber Eats restaurants here in Boston. So we just want you to relax, take it easy, and enjoy the webinar. All right, so now before we get started, just going over a little bit of this webinar format. It's not exactly just like a Zoom meeting. So we're gonna have a poll that we're gonna launch during the meeting where you'll be able to answer some questions. So please pay attention to the information that we're about to give you, because you might be questioned on it later. We also have surveys. We, especially the Afro-American, would appreciate the survey. We're going to send it to everybody tomorrow along with the video for this program. And you'll also get a little pop-up after you leave of a survey. So please help us fill out the survey, because that's how we know how to make these kind of events better for you. There's a Q&A section part of your Zoom webinar infrastructure. And we would appreciate if you put the questions in there, so that when we get to the end, we can already have some questions and some ideas. Maybe we'll be able to answer them really good if we can get a little cheat sheet on it. At the end, I always give time to talk, because I know sometimes people have a lot of great things to share after they get the content. So we want to hear from you. Feel free to comment in the chat, of course. And like I said, we'll have the Uber Eats giveaway at the end. Finally, we just always say everybody to respect everybody because we're a family. So, like I said, what we are doing is we talk about African culture and how African culture is represented here in the African diaspora. African diaspora, in our definition, means African Americans, Afro-Latin, Afro-Caribbean, and of course, African immigrants. We also recognize that a lot of people that live in our communities and interact and, you know, and love us and, you know, they're not from African descent. We call them friends of Africa. And we, of course, they're part of our family too. So one of the things that we're going to talk about today is the importance of cultural cuisine and how it not only is just culture, you know, for the sake of culture. There's actually a very nice video that I saw the other day, and it's about what it means to be African diaspora. And it means, and when people talk of culture, they just look at it as, well, it's just something you do because of culture. It's my culture. You know, I do this because it's my culture. But culture is a way of life. And if it's a way of life, it also means that it's a way of survival. And you do things in your culture because you need to survive as a culture. So this culture, this, all the things that your culture does is inherently designed to make you healthier, happier, you know, and over who knows how many millennia these foods have been developed, some closer than others, but, you know, I'm half Nigerian. So that, you know, that could be, I don't know, 500, you know, 1,500, 2,000 years of development. It just naturally grows and is part of your who you are. So now in the diaspora, a lot of the different ingredients, because of the history of the Americas, you know, has a lot to do with trade, slavery, and a lot of cultural artifacts. And when I say cultural artifact can be a recipe as well. It's not just, you know, maybe a piece of art. No, it's actually a recipe. That's a cultural artifact. Language is a cultural artifact, right? And these cultural artifacts are, you know, now melted in because of people from India, America, everybody in, and African culture. And you have these beautiful, beautiful different kinds of foods, right? And one of the ones that actually has a connection to where I'm from, like I said, my little bit about my history is my father's a Nigerian and my mother is an African-American. She's from Virginia. So I have this little dual bicultural thing going on. And I found it very interesting that one of the foods I grew up with in Nigeria is called akara. Now I have to get back into my Nigerian accents before I can say it properly. So akara, that's the way you say it properly. It's a dish made from peeled beans and you grind the beans up and you put peppers and onions in and then you fry it. So it's fried. So it's not exactly the healthiest, but it, you know, it's got a lot of other great ingredients and stuff to it. And it's eaten as a snack or also in breakfast food, right? It's from the Yoruba tribe in Nigeria. That's from the Western side. The Yoruba tribe in Nigeria, very proud tribe. They, you know, in fact, they, you know, they're known for their spirituality. They're known for their artistry. All the great art, a lot of great artists come from that area, and also their religion, which also spread to Brazil. A lot of the Brazilian, they have enough cultural artifacts in Brazil that they can actually trace their heritage directly to a place in a culture directly in Africa, and they trace it to the Yoruba tribe. And not only that, cultural artifacts like actually this recipe was able to travel across the Atlantic with the slave trade and is blossoming and is in Brazil. Now, it's called akarajé. So it's very similar, right? Akara and akarajé. And if you know the Yoruba language, je means to eat. In fact, unje means food. Then je means to eat. So akara je, just knowing the language, is like, I can imagine somebody that did not understand maybe the complete Yoruba, or maybe it was Yoruba people that after a few generations of being enslaved and, you know, living their culture in Brazil, they somehow mixed the two. And so in lost in translation, akara turned to its great-great-great-grandson, akaraje. So that's a little about the history. It's found in the northeastern state of Bahia. That was the former capital of Brazil where all the slaves went. In fact, 40% of the slaves that were brought over to the Americas, they were in, they ended up in Brazil, right? So you can see that it's even grown. You can see that this is how we eat the akara, just like this. You know, on the left is the akara, right? Then on the right with the shrimps and the, I think they call it vatapa, that's the akaraje. We don't put the shrimp and the other stuff, they funkified it and it's like an upgrade in Brazil, right? But some of the greatest things about this, and it's kind of known as a street food. Now, one of the things about cultural food that's extremely important is that it provides an economic opportunity. So just knowing the recipe and having the cultural artifact and bringing it abroad gave, who knows how many akaraje have been sold in the last 500 years. I'm sure it's a lot. And that has provided not only cultural pride, not only an identity to the black Brazilians, right? It also provides healthy, look at that, shrimp and ginger and coconut milk and palm oil, cashews, peanuts, herbs. It also has the black-eyed peas, right? It's got a lot of, so it's already giving you your natural ingredients because you're eating your cultural food. And you get to sell your cultural food, or you get to grow the ingredients. You get to go to the river and become a fisherman and get the shrimp. So it provides an opportunity, economic opportunities down the food chain, right? And well, I guess up the food chain, if you think the restaurant is, you know, selling finished akaraje, and providing money and economic foundations, which are extremely important to every culture. Here in Boston, we have Chinatown. Here in Boston, we have Little Italy, the North End. These are all selling cultural foods, and we all know the importance of these cultural foods to the economic viability of these areas. All right? So now we're gonna watch a little bit of a video, right, about the Caribbean cultural foods. The Caribbean, of course, was a huge seaport. This is where, whence the slaves came, or the goods came, because it wasn't just slaves being transported. All sorts of goods and other merchandise were being, that is in Cuba and Caribbean. They were settled. Okay, you are going to Brazil, you're going to Georgia, you're going to Mexico, or wherever, you know, Venezuela, wherever the slaves were going. That was like the distribution house, so to speak. So there's a lot of cultural foods that ended up there. So let's watch this video and learn a little bit more about what happened over there.
Take a look at these dishes. Whether you live in the Caribbean or visited the region or simply been to a restaurant serving Caribbean cuisine, you've probably tasted one or more of these dishes. Many of them and the culture that they represent have been popularized the world over. Here's a Caribbean fusion restaurant in Canada. Here's one of many in the United States. Here's one in Germany. Here's one even in Hong Kong. This style of cuisine has become synonymous with the laid-back, fun-in-the-sun lifestyle of the Caribbean. But it wasn't always so. In fact, some of the ingredients in the very food we eat today have a much darker history to them than what meets the eye. What you'll find out is that this is what you get and cultures from all over the world, over a span of centuries of adding their own ingredients into the pot, making what we call today Caribbean cuisine. Imagine the Caribbean as an empty clay pot for now. Watch and see how different cultures start to add to that pot. When you look at many of the fruits that have been most synonymous with the Caribbean, such as breadfruit, mangoes, and sugarcane, we automatically think these fruits originated from the Caribbean, right? But the truth is, they're not. You have the European settlers to thank for that, as the Spanish, French, and English introduced many of these fruits and ingredients from other places. So the next question you might be asking, if breadfruit, mangoes, and sugarcane aren't Caribbean in origin, then what is? That would be the yams, papayas, guavas, and cassava scattered around the archipelago. This was the diet of the first true settlers of the Caribbean, the Carib, Arawak, and Taino tribes that came from South and Central America. And when it comes to the seasoning of meats and fish, the Caribs introduced various spices to their recipes. After the Amerindians and Europeans' contribution to this pot, came the Africans through the Atlantic slave trade, and this is where things started to get a little dark with regards to food. You see, for the Africans, blending different unfamiliar ingredients into their recipes wasn't a matter of delicacy. It was often essential to their survival. A slave's diet in those days mostly consisted of the foods that their slave masters didn't want to eat themselves, so they had to get creative. They blended their traditional African foods with the staple foods they found on the islands, introducing things such as okra, kalalu, saltfish, and ackee into the mix. You could say that they were the ones who actually started to stir this Caribbean pot of foods together, making it closer to the familiar recipes we see today. Next would be the Chinese and Indian indentured laborers who would come and introduce such ingredients as rice and curry, and sailors who moved back and forth through the Americas to a lesser extent brought in the ingredients they got there as well, like corn, beans, potatoes, and tomatoes, making the pot of Caribbean cuisine we know and love today. You might wonder, if each island developed their cuisine individually, how did they all develop generally the same Caribbean fusion taste? Well, actually, they kind of didn't, and did at the same time. As each island developed their own cuisine, they ended up with some very unique dishes, almost exclusive to their respective islands, and in some cases becoming that island's national dish, such as ackee and saltfish in Jamaica, and greenfig and saltfish in St. Lucia. But there are also some dishes, as a result of many of the same ingredients being accessible in each island, recipes such as cook-up or palau, as it's called in some parts, became common throughout the region. And we can't talk about Caribbean food without mentioning the seasoning. Seasoning, which in the Caribbean is a green herb and oil-based marinade, is actually quintessential to its flavor and is used in just about every island in the region. As a result, giving this part of the world its distinct character. One thing is for certain, Caribbean cuisine is a clear example of what can happen when a region becomes one of the crossroads of the world. Had the Atlantic trade winds not been there to carry the many different cultures from around the world through this region, we wouldn't have this amazing amalgamation of cultures to celebrate today. In fact, Caribbean cuisine actually stands as a testament to the diversity of the region that we celebrate. When we eat our favorite local dish as Caribbean people, we're eating what represents a mirror of who we are. Not as Amerindians or Europeans or Africans or even Asians, but as Caribbean people, a melting pot of cultures.
I always love that video. It just gives such a great opening into how many influences they are into the food, right? From Amerindians, the original inhabitants of North America, to Europeans, to Africans, to Asian, Indian, and Chinese, all mixed in to make one beautiful food. And that's kind of what, you know, this whole organization is about right there. So one of the key aspects to African America, what actually started it. My mother's, she's from Virginia. She's African American. I got to see my great grandfather, whose grandfather was a slave. And connecting the two cultures of my Nigerian side and my African American side is really the driving force behind starting this organization. So we have a policy called African Americans First Policy, where recognizing how most of these cultural artifacts, because of the American unique experience, which has been way more intense and way longer than any other form of American slavery, even Brazilian slavery, it ended 20 years later than American slavery, but it just was not as intense. There were even parts of Brazil where the escaped slaves could have towns, 40,000 population towns, and they were living free, you know, when plantations were, you know, close by. That was not that ability to have that community, share their culture, really involve themselves in who they are. That was not allowed. So the African American experience, when you now add Jim Crow, the civil rights, you know, all the up into the time of the civil rights movement, up till now, and George Floyd and systemic racism, all that has served to really strip a lot of my African American brothers and sisters of these African artifacts. These artifacts serve to provide identity, like I said, protect cultural foods. Protect and give cultural protection in terms of good diet and diverse diet with a lot of vitamins and different, and also economic opportunities, because obviously, like I said, acarajé was sold all over Brazil. Who knows how many millions of acarajé has been sold in the last 500 years or so, 400 years or so. So the ability to have a restaurant and use, and sell food and have a North End and all that, these are kind of economic opportunities that African Americans, because they don't have the recipes, don't do. And that's why I really partnered with Oldways, because they teach people how to cook, and they teach people African heritage diet and Latin heritage diet and other heritage diets. So it will give opportunities for people to learn the recipes and also, hey, start a couple of restaurants, make some nice money. Now, this is one of my favorite comedian skits, and it's about an African-American restaurant and some of the soul food. And of course, there's some little imagery in there about how, of course, just like the slaves in Jamaica, but of course, Jamaicans and Brazilians had more freedom to practice culture. They only could eat what the slave masters did not want, right? A lot to do a lot of the control that was over them. So they didn't get to develop a lot of these things. So that being said, let's watch this little, it's funny. I think it does too much.
So glad we could bring this project to this neighborhood.
Oh, it's so rich in history.
I grew up in a neighborhood like this.
Oh, yeah, I grew up in a neighborhood exactly like this.
All right, welcome to Mama Sugarbanks. Y'all ready to order?
Yeah. Can I have a chicken fried steak with gravy and a cola?
I will have the baked beef short ribs with collard greens and throw down some of that cornbread.
All right, babe.
You know what? Hold up a second. I'm also going to have some of them collard greens and cornbread as well, but hook a brother up with some of them hot links.
All right.
You know what? Why am I trying to front? Scratch all that. Give me some okra and some fried red snapper, and girl, you know I want some chitlins.
All right, man.
Y'all got ham hocks?
Of course.
Well, that's what I want. I want a plate of ham hocks, deep fried, blackened, and served on a bed of mustard greens.
Pig feet. I want some pig feet and 4 pounds of grits. And you know what else? Give me a little Dixie cup full of lard. All right.
I just remember what I want, a bowl of mosquitoes. None of them tiny ones either. Give me them big motherfuckers you find down at the swamp.
Sister, could you please hook a brother up with a rusty bucket full of fish heads wrapped in razor wire?
Donk your teeth.
Donk your teeth.
Straight out a donkey's mouth. You know what? F it. Any animal tooth will do. I want you to stick it in some honey glaze, fry it with fat back, and serve it in an old tin coffee can.
Forget everything I said up to this point right now. Bring me some dandelion greens, a cow hip, and a dog face. Wrap that whole mess in an old Ebony magazine and serve it to me in a shoebox.
Okay, I want a platter of stork ankles, an old cellar door, a possum spine, and a human foot.
You want a human foot.
Mm-hmm.
I got just one question for y'all. You want gravy on that cellar door?
Oh, definitely.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you gotta put gravy on there.
What's a cellar door without gravy?
It's not food.
So, like I said, they're just hilarious. But one of the things, you know, we have to, you know, so when we now look at African-American food, there's still a lot of what I call cultural resilience. This is like, you know, how they were like, you know, in the skit, while they were trying to like out-black each other with how soulful their food will be. You know, they, you know, when you don't have the cultural artifacts, you don't have a much of any kind of like real direction on how you need to go. Like I said, the Brazilians, they know, hey, it's Yoruba. But African Americans didn't have that pleasure. So now they came up with soul food. And it now becomes a, you know, and this came up in the 60s during the first, what I call the first rebellion after slavery, which was the in the 1960s when Martin Luther King and all of them were marching, you know, for their freedom. And this, these are some of the self-determination cultural aspects that started to burgeon at that time. And soul food is one of them. Although there are some African-American cultural foods that could, I guess, more considered more cultural, but it's also, but it's kind of like, you can talk about like in New Orleans, but I think that has to do a lot with the French background of those areas, which now have the Cajun and, you know, and then you have cultural cuisines like jambalaya and jumbo, but I mean gumbo. Is that jumbo? Gumbo. So I hope, you know, so it's very important because of these cultural facts that something like the African Heritage Diet is available for African Americans to take advantage of. And I fully intend work with not just African Heritage Diet, was it not just the old ways, but also they have ambassadors, they teach teachers, they have all sorts of programs to help people learn about cultural foods. You know, I'm working with a school in my local area and their food provider, and sometimes it's difficult to get these kids to eat good food. How about if cultural food is one of the ways we can go to get tasty, exciting foods? We can tie it into their culture and education. And these are the kind of programs that the Afro-American Culture Initiative is interested in championing. And with your support, we can really make a difference in the health of our kids. And in fact, the school that we're working with in particular, there's a Burger King right across the street from the school and here in Hyde Park. So we are definitely feel that school in particular would need some nice programming for this kind of food. So of course, some of the participation by some of their ambassadors and some of the teachers is what we're looking to do. But what it does, it empowers people with the idea of connecting with their heritage and eating healthy. It doesn't, you know, culture is fun. I mean, you know, when I see the akara, oh my God, my whole body is shaking. I need to eat, you know, or some Nigerian food. This feeling is more than just the food, right? Like, it is the health. If you give people raw materials, if I go to somebody and give somebody plantains, give somebody the beans, give somebody the veggies, give somebody all the, you know, whole healthy fruits and vegetables, but the person doesn't have the recipes to make it, or doesn't know how to cook and practice how to cook, because most of us, that's one thing people realize, all cultures, this food is taught from prior generations. So if there's a break between your culture in the generations, then you lose a lot of that institutional knowledge, so to speak, that will keep you healthy, that will provide you a financial foundation. And I think that old ways and what they teach is a way to get there. So I'll play their intro video and then we'll let Sarah take over.
This is more than just about food. It really is about shaping people's identity and how they see themselves through their food, how they see their culture being a part of their health solution. The Taste of African Heritage and Health program is for anyone, whether it's been trying to lose weight, improve their health, lacking cooking skills, don't know other creative ways, enhance their meals in their homes. The research really does show that when we eat a more traditional heritage diet, that we improve our health outcomes. And I think that's really the core of what Oldways is about and what it's doing in terms of helping the community. This program now with the Taste of African Heritage and Health.
African Heritage Diet Pyramid was created with a committee of nutrition scientists, experts in culinary history and African American foodways.
It's much easier to do because you can identify with that. I know what greens are. And so I can identify with, eat a lot of this. You can have the brown rice and the millet and you know, the barley. You have all of these healthy whole grains here.
And those kinds of grains that really is a part of the heritage that needs to be built upon. On top of that, the tubers, the healthy starches from the yams to the sweet potatoes. And then you have the balance of fruits that will come from everything from the tropical fruits like the papayas, the melons, the mangoes, the pineapples, the bananas, plantains, and them serving as really desserts compared to what we traditionally have now.
Once you sort of shift your mindset to looking at your plate as more of a heritage plate, it's going to redefine everything that you can put on there. So when you look at a plate now and you say, that should have some whole grains, or that should have and beans and my greens and my vegetables, fruit for dessert.
And it's so empowering. This idea of connecting to your heritage and improving your health through connecting to your heritage.
In the Taste of African Heritage and Health program, we evaluate how the students are going through the process and what lessons that we can learn to improve the program and what it has mean for their life and for their family, and most of all, how they have improved their health.
So my name is Danessa Bowling. I live in Houston. I am actually on my fourth series of the class. I committed myself to do this for a full year. So it was a time of a serious transition for me. And so at this point, I had lost my mom, my grandmother, and my aunt to cancer. It's like, okay, being realistic, I'm overweight. I'm at risk for diabetes. Yeah, I'm African American. I just didn't know what to do. I can't control cancer. I can't control heart disease. I can't control diabetes. I can control this. This is my thing I can do. And so I thought, well, I'll do it and I'll teach it and it'll help me. Is in addition to teaching and learning and eating healthy, you get this sense of community with people.
This idea of culture being a part of your medicine. We talk about cultural competency, but we never really see the integration of culture in the form of community programs. And the Taste of African Heritage and Health program does the very thing that the community has been longing for and why it's being embraced so much more than ever and why it's so desperately needed.
I believe that this can be the thing that could bring people together, where we could break down some barriers that we never thought could be broken down with food.
The idea of our culture and our community, they both are tied into our cuisine, can be a part of our medicine, our nutrition. That's what this program provides more than ever.
Right. Like I said, this program is phenomenal. And they have my full support. And I'm, you know, just looking to do more stuff with the ambassadors of this great organization. And now I will let Sarah take over.
Great. So what you just watched was a video overview of our African Heritage Program, and that was some of our lovely ambassadors of the program. I would like to reintroduce myself. My name is Sarah, and I'm the Curriculum Coordinator for A Taste of African Heritage. So I bet you're probably wondering, on to the next slide, what is A Taste of African Heritage? It's a six-week cooking and nutrition curriculum based on healthy plant-based foods across the African diaspora. And regions that are included would be West and Central Africa, the American South, the Caribbean, and South America. Within, over to the right-hand side, you'll see our African Heritage Diet Pyramid. This pyramid was developed in 2011 by registered dietitians, chefs, and African culinary scholars. And this pyramid essentially makes up the foundation of our A Taste of African Heritage curriculum. Now, here are the six lessons that we include within the curriculum. We have herbs and spices, leafy greens, whole grains, beans and rice, tubers and mashes, and fruits and vegetables. This is really important because we focus on a plant-based diet, and that's kind of how Oldways rolls. So now you're probably questioning on ways of bringing our African Heritage program to your own community. So we offer two ways of licensing the subscription. We have our going through our web store where you can purchase the teacher's manual and the student handbooks that usually come in a bundle of 15, or you can purchase our digital curriculum, which includes the ebooks of the teacher's manual, the student handbooks, and also the teacher inserts. This is all the virtual resources with our yearly subscription. And we just like to offer various ways because some people may be teaching more than one class series in a year. And so if that is the case, the yearly subscription is honestly a great resource. Yeah, so before we start this video, let me tell you about a popular dish from our curriculum. That would be our mafé stew. It's a Central West African dish, and various versions of the stew includes meat or seafood, but we offer the plant-based version. And honestly, it's better if you ask me. It has the delicious like peanut sauce with the tomatoes and the sweet potato. And it's just a really nice fall favorite. So please enjoy this video cooking demo of creating the recipe. And we'll also include the recipe on our resource page, which Marlon has graciously created for everyone. So enjoy.
So let's get started. So first you're going to take your one onion that is diced, and you're going to first put some oil. We're going to fry the onion and the garlic together. So I'm gonna pour some oil. The recipe calls for a pre-measured amount of oil. I just kind of do as desired, but I would suggest following the recipe for that. I'm just basically letting it coat my pan, and I'm going to pour in my onion. And it's about two cloves of garlic. This is one clove here. So you dice up two cloves of garlic, and I'm going to pour my garlic in right now. So now what you're going to do is you're going to go and put your, it's a mixture right here. You're going to go and put this on the stove, and you're going to let it fry for about, you know, 2-3 minutes until it's translucent. So we're going to put it on our stove right now. All right. So now we have our freshly fried onions and garlic. It's a great smell. And basically you're going to cook them until they're translucent. So just kind of a little bit see-through. And you're going to pour them into a nice little regular stock pot that you have, or stew pot that you might have at home. So, you pour that in into the pot. And now what you're going to do is you're going to add your vegetables. So you're going to pour in your zucchini. Thank you. your sweet potatoes. And essentially what you're going to do is you are going to put them back up. You're going to put this back on the oven. You're going to cover it, and you're going to let it simmer a little bit for about 3 to 4 minutes. So essentially, you're not going to cook your vegetables for very long. It's going to be a really short, it's going to be about 3 or 4 minutes. You're just going to kind of let them, you're going to stir them a little bit, let them cook just a little bit because they're also going to cook when you're making the rest of the stew. So this is just a great, beautiful mixture. I love this recipe as well because of all the beautiful colors that are represented. It's like such, so nice aesthetically, and it's great, it's very aesthetically pleasing. And you have your nice little mixture of zucchini and sweet potato and carrots that are right here. And I think it's also very healthy, you know, sweet potatoes and carrots are both really high in beta carotene, which is really great for your eyesight and have great health benefits. And zucchini, it's a great way for you to get your vegetables, your carbs, and a little bit of spice and flavor all in one meal. So now we're going to make the liquid part of the stew, of our stew. So you're going to pour in your diced tomatoes. So it's about one can of diced tomatoes, or you can dice your own tomatoes. Keep the sauce and just kind of pour it in and mix it into your pot. And then you're going to take about 2 cups of vegetable broth. I've already pre-measured it out here, low sodium vegetable broth, and just pour that in. And then you're going to mix that in. Just make sure everything kind of gets mixed up. And the tomatoes and the vegetable broth essentially are the liquid basis for your stew. The tomatoes add a great thickness, and the stew kind of, you know, gives it its liquidy aspect. So I'm gonna mix that in a little bit, and essentially what you're gonna do is you're going to put this back on the stove for about 10 minutes, and you're going to let it simmer. So here is our beautiful mafe with all the different ingredients. You see how gorgeous that looks? And we're going to now add the last final ingredients to it. So we're gonna take about 1/4 cup of peanut butter, and I've already pre-measured it out here. So here's the peanut butter here. And we're going to take that, and we're just gonna pour it into our pot. Very sticky. To me, it was very interesting to use peanut butter as part of a stew. But honestly, it adds such a great taste, especially in combination with the sweet potato. So first you're gonna add some peanut butter. You're gonna take your 3 sprigs of thyme that you already pre-chopped and just kind of pour that in there. And lastly, you're going to take about 1 tablespoon of curry powder. I'm gonna open this up right here. And I'm just going to go and measure out about 1 tablespoon. You can go, pour that there. You can also add, depending on your preferences, a little bit of salt. The recipe already has a lot of flavor, so I don't really think that much salt is needed, but I like to sprinkle just a little bit over it. And now you just kind of mix that in with all the rest of the ingredients that you have. Make sure everything's in. And essentially what you're going to do is you're going to put this back on the stove for about 3 to 5 minutes. And that's it. Your mafe stew is done and ready to serve. So beautiful array of colors. I'm gonna pour it out into a bowl so you can see. And it's great for lunch or dinner. You can pour it over rice. You can also add meat, chicken, lamb, stew to this recipe. But we recommend a vegetarian recipe with no meat. It's like a lot healthier, but makes a great little stew. This is what it looks like. It's all nice and fresh. And great colors and great everything.
Great, so that was the cooking demo on the mafe stew. One thing I forgot to mention is What I love about a lot of our recipes that we have within the curriculum, but also on our Oldways website, is usually does not take that long to prep. I say it's probably about to cook the entire recipe, it's 15 minutes or less. Most of the time you spend is chopping onions or garlic or prepping the ingredients, but it's just such a fun experience. So highly encouraged, but let's move on to interest in becoming an African heritage instructor with us. We have four simple steps. You can go on our website, but also be included in the research page to fill out an interest form, and then you would watch a free 1 hour training video, and it would look like the video over on the right hand side, and then you can take a quiz. Once you submit your quiz results, I'll receive a notification and send you back a certificate. The certificate is important because, you know, it now approves that you can teach the African Heritage series. So it's a required step, but it's a lot of fun in the process. Now, so let's talk about what you will gain from our Taste of African Heritage program. One thing I think that's really important is just confidence and improvement in presentation skills. You know, it really forces you to go out and, you know, have these classes teach this instruction. And that's always a good lesson for anyone. I would say also food and nutritional training regarding the African diaspora, leadership skills, community engagement, empowerment. You know, with COVID-19 going on, a lot of people are feeling socially isolated, and it's a great way to engage with friends, family, and the community. And you can do that in the virtual setting. I would also say the most important thing is empowerment to help switch the narrative of African-American cuisine being greasy and unhealthy. You know, when you go back to what the roots, what your ancestors were eating, we weren't utilizing salt and, you know, all these unhealthy ingredients. It was what you had in the backyard or what was local. And so, you know, that's kind of what Oldways and what we do in our heritage diet is definitely switching the narrative to make it say, you know, this wasn't unhealthy originally. It's always been healthy, you know, just as time has gone, but we are going back to that. So cooking the old way style. So now I would love to show you guys some teacher testimonials. And it'll feature two of our African Heritage ambassadors. We have the lovely Dietra, who's Georgia based, and then our Philly instructor, Claire. And they'll just tell their stories, and I think it's awesome to hear. So please enjoy.
My name is Dietra Dennis, and I'm a registered nurse and a National Board Certified Health and Wellness Coach here in the Atlanta, Georgia area. I've been a Taste of African Heritage instructor since 2015. Well, if you wouldn't mind me sharing a little bit about my background before, you know, how did I arrive at being an instructor? So being a nurse, you know, I really had the opportunity to meet some great patients. And many of them have had impact on my life, but there was one patient in particular. He was well over 500 pounds, and he was in the hospital for a long time. And having the opportunity to be his nurse during his stay, you know, had a chance to talk to him for quite a bit. And, you know, like, how did he get to that point, and what was he going to do to, once he got home, to sustain a healthy lifestyle? So he was discharged to an inpatient rehab because he had to learn to walk again and everything. And so when he went home, he went back to his old way of eating. And I'm sad to report that that young man passed away, and he was in his 20s. So that really, you know, made me start rethinking about nursing care. So I began a journey of transitioning my nursing care from the bedside to the sidelines as a health coach, because the talking that I was doing to him was coaching before I knew what coaching was. And then also taking the nursing care to the table side, because as I, you know, was offering things in the community before becoming an instructor, whenever I talked about food, people were always excited and engaged. You know, food connects us, you know. And so I started on that journey. And so I really wanted a curriculum to help people sustain a healthy lifestyle. And again, when you talk about lifestyle, nutrition is 50% of that. And so I was looking for a curriculum that was one, evidence-based, and two, culturally relevant. And here I came upon A Taste of Africa, well, Oldways, the company, and then their curriculum, A Taste of African Heritage. So that is how I got to where I am today. First, heard of Taste of African Heritage. I didn't know what it was. And we partner with the library once again, like I said. So my boss said, someone needs to go, because we all support one another. Someone needs to go to this first, heard of Taste of African Heritage. I didn't know what it was. And we partner with the library once again, like I said. So my boss said, someone needs to go, because we all support one another. Someone needs to go to this demonstration of this new class they're going to be teaching, Taste of African Heritage. Who from here wants to go? My organization. We're all tired. Everybody's like, oh, I don't feel like going. I'm tired. I went to something last week. Oh, I went. So I left me and another girl. So I'm like, fine, I'll go. Meanwhile, I'll start cooking the rice while I'm chatting. So I'm like, okay, I'll go. So we go, and when we get in there, there is a woman cooking. She's all, you know, I didn't understand. I didn't know what it was going to be about. So she has on like an African head garb. Come to find out, her name is Dijanaba. She's awesome. And come to find out that that's what Dijanaba wears all the time. She's amazing. So anyway, Dijanaba's talking about Taste of African Heritage and the different diets and how we could benefit from it and who would be interested in teaching it. So she made a few things from the menu. One of them was something called garlicky greens. So it's collard greens, which we're all traditionally used to. So there's collard greens. She made the sweet potato stew, the mafé. And I thought, who is doing that? Who is making sweet potatoes in a stew? Like, I never heard of such. So then there was she has the black eyed pea salad. And I was like, I never liked them anyway. I don't know about this. Why am I here again? So she makes the collard greens, and they call for mustard instead of meat. You're using mustard to get the smoky flavor. Now, the first time I heard that, I am not gonna lie to you, I heard, and she said, and we're gonna use mustard to get our smoky flavor, and we don't use a lot of water. I was like, who is this person? And who made this diet? And why are they talking to us about it? So I sat up there with my arms folded, like, I wasted an afternoon, I had other things to do. I listened to her, she gave a great presentation. She showed how she made the greens, but everything else was pretty much made, and they just brought it out the back, set it up for us to get a little taste. First thing I went to was the greens, okay? Because I'm thinking, I want to taste these greens with mustard. These people are crazy. So I'm watching everyone's face as they taste it and go down the line, and not one disappointed face. I said, these people don't know. For real, they just hear, they don't know what they're supposed to be tasting. So then it's my turn. I get some greens, they give you like a little bowl, and I get the greens and I taste it. And I was like, taste some more. And I looked at her and she was kind of looking at me, because I guess I must have sat there looking like I was five with my arms folded. So she said, so what do you think? I said, these are pretty good. She said, yeah, I know. They surprise you, don't they? I said, yes, they do. And by the way, lemon is the new salt, because there's no salt in those greens. It's lemon. Now, it might take some getting used to. Some people might have to use salt after they try that, but y'all, that's how I make my greens now. Who knew? I didn't think I'd be interested in that.
Great. So that was some of our testimonials from our African Heritage instructors and ambassadors. One thing I love about our community is that especially our ambassadors, they are really out on the field working with clients one-on-one and really spreading that knowledge. And it's specifically with Deetra, I'll even add her website on the chat. She offers coaching, one-on-one coaching, and she talks a lot about the African diaspora, and it's also included on our research page. But she has her own practice, and it's amazing to, you know, definitely empower our instructors. So please feel free and look more into what she has to offer. But thank you so much for listening to me today and joining the webinar.
Yeah, well, I think you did a great job, Sarah. I really enjoyed your presentation. Right now, of course, it's time for questions and answers. And we do have a question that somebody put in the question part. And it goes, this is from Deetra. Okay, Deetra. So Deetra says she's an ambassador of Taste of African Heritage in Georgia. How can I support you from another state? Well, the great thing now I'd say is that Zoom is very important. So, you know, we're doing a lot of, I'm looking to do presentations, you know, so if you have presentations like, you know, that you would like to do to maybe people in your community, I could definitely partner with you. You would take Sarah's part over here and, you know, because she can't be with me. As much as we'd love her to be with us, she cannot be with us all the time. So, you know, and that's the way we can do it. We have a website, of course, visit there. We have, you know, getting donations, things like that. I mean, it's normal 501c3 stuff. Okay, yep, no problem, definitely. We have a resource page. I put the link inside the chat box, so it's all there for you to see. Now, the thing I wanted to do, because, let me quickly segue out of this because I want to give our Uber Eats voucher. And the idea, of course, behind the Uber Eats voucher is that you will use it on one of our restaurants, because during this COVID-19, we really need to try and help, you know, the people out there, because it's just not easy. Now, what I did was I put everybody's email that signed up for the book here. But what I'm going to do is that for you coming, I'm going to run the itemizer and hopefully we can pick somebody that is here. But it's random. So it's not. So if your email is called, can you please like put yourself in the chat and let me know that, yes, that's your email, so we'll know we have a winner of the $50 Uber Eats voucher. So I guess let me do that. And who won this time? Do we have Thatch? T Hatch, I think I know T Hatch. She is here. Hey, Taryn, you won the itemizer. Let me allow you to talk. Do you want to say something? Maybe she, no, anyway, I don't want to put people on blast. People are like, don't be putting me on blast. Well, Taryn, I've asked you to unmute. Okay, go ahead. Hi.
Hi.
So you won the $50 Uber Eats voucher.
Oh, thank you.
I'm so happy because I was wondering, because, you know, some people didn't come. So I put everybody's email in there and I was hoping that the person that won would, you know, be the person who picked up. So you have $50 Uber Eats to eat around town, I guess.
I'm super excited. I know a bunch of restaurants around the school that I'm interested in trying.
All right, excellent. So we thank you for supporting the local businesses. Is there any more questions? Because now is the time where, thank you, Taryn. Yeah, so now is the time that, you know, I definitely want, we're really kind of done with the presentation, but if anybody has any questions or anything else that, okay, we have some more questions. Okay, Victoria Cooper says, I'm enjoying this program. The presenters are knowledgeable and you've shared a lot of information. However, I would be more interested in attending a class than being an instructor. Do you have a cookbook? So I think that's for Sarah.
Yeah, if you go on our Oldways website under our African Heritage Program, we have a class directory where we allow instructors the freedom to upload their information about their upcoming classes. And you can find that information always available on our Oldways website. And yeah, it's a great resource. And also as far as a cookbook, so we offer the curriculum to be taught, but I guess the resource that I have right next to me that I can always mention is we have the Good For Me recipes. And I would say this is on the individual level. So, you know, say if you want to teach it at home with your own kids or family, it doesn't offer as many less recipes, of course, as the curriculum, but it offers a few. And it's great because it was developed with the National Black Child Development Institute. So it's a great resource. And you can also find that on our website. But if you're looking for general recipes too, we have a lot of free resources and recipes on the website. So I definitely recommend you go and try them and give us feedback.
That's awesome. Yeah. So like you said, we have a lot of these. We have a lot of the resources. If you check the chat box, you'll see the resources we have there. Inside that resources, we have everything. It's just a Google Doc. So I put all these little resources together. I'm going to post it again. Right. And you can go there and all my contacts are there. Sarah's contacts are there. Great. All the videos that we showed today, they're there. They're all on YouTube. Tomorrow, you're going to get this video back as well as you'll get this video and you'll also get, your Uber Eats out voucher will be sent out and you'll get the resources. You'll get a link to the resources so you'll know everything that's going on. Any other questions or anybody want to talk? Because I can let, you know, if anybody wants to say anything, raise your hand. I definitely want to hear from people, the feedback. Like I said, we're trying to definitely grow this program. We're trying to offer this program in schools. Just basically anybody that'll listen because it's such an important message. So if you know anybody that you, or you know any particular area that you think that, you know, Oldways and Afro-American Culture Initiative can, spread the message, please let us know. And we'll try to see what we can do to make it happen. Any other questions? All right, well. Oh, Deitra raised her hand. All right, great, great, great. I'm like, don't let me, I want to hear something. I don't want to just be. Where are you at, Deitra? Let me get you out of here. There you go.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Well, good afternoon to good evening to everyone. Congratulations on the great work that you're doing in the community of Boston. but I would like to know, are there any plans to expand to other states in what you're doing?
Yeah, like I said, I mean, the great thing about it now is that I'm everywhere, you know?
Yeah.
with the Zoom. So, I'm definitely looking up, to provide other opportunities, doing similar or even more tailored presentations.
Okay.
We're doing an online school, so we actually have a little bit of a general curriculum, but ours has to do more with, just overall cultural health and wellness. So we're doing a lot of stuff, and yeah, definitely want to expand out to everywhere. I mean, hey, we want to be worldwide.
Yes. It's much needed. And as Sarah has mentioned, and you as well, is very much needed. And when there is a gap in the generations of truly being connected to heritage, I mean, we have a lot of work to do, you know, to help close that gap. So I look forward to connecting so that we can together get this out and allowing, because, you know, we're disproportionately impacted by chronic diseases, and nutrition is 50% of lifestyle. So if we can get the nutrition part underway by returning to the old ways or the cultural food traditions, we can turn that narrative around for our community.
I completely agree. It's something that is, you know, I take on and I put this on like the forefront of what we're doing, because it's just overlooked. It's like nobody just thinks about it, you know? Mm-hmm. And then it's sort of put on us to define that. But how are we going to define something, like you said, when there's this huge cultural gap between where we are as African Americans and where we were 400 years ago, you know? So, and I always tell people, African-Americans were the only ones that have this particular issue. Everybody's got their culture. At least, even if you're Jamaican, you've had a, you know, like I said, they have their own, you know, because they were allowed to be it's a Black country now. So they've been allowed to live a culture. Mm-hmm. And we have a culture, and our culture needs to be diversified, I think is the proper way to say it. We need to add other things and also contribute to the greater African diaspora message that's out there. So I'm definitely interested in going, you know, and I wish I could come to Atlanta for real, for real. But I'll take Zoom for now.
That's right. Well, certainly I will email you once we're done, and then we'll connect to, you know, we can get the word out together. We can accomplish and conquer more together, working collaboratively, because it's not a competition. We're out here together in order to make a difference.
Man and dad system.
Yes.
All right. Well, anybody else? I want to hear from more people. This is the best time to really get like honest feedback. And also, please, we have surveys. I'm going to send you the survey tomorrow morning. So please, if you've been here, this is how we can measure our outcomes, you know, and really understand how we are making a positive impact in our community. I would also invite you to go to our YouTube, and we have some other events we've done. One in particular, especially for African Americans, we give away a free DNA test every year. And this is our third year of doing it. And we have this collection of wonderful women who have found out their actual cultural tribe in Africa. And they've won the first scholar Lives in Me competition. Our first Lives in Me winner, we call her Somali Michelle, because there's a bunch of Michelles. She found out she was from the Cameroonian tribe of Bamileke. And not only did we find out that she was from Cameroonian tribe from Bamileke, I was able to find her a culture guide. Somebody that's from the tribe of Bamileke, an actual African immigrant. And we have now grown to this little five, there are five of them now, you know, Justina, Shireen, Michelle, then the culture guide, her name is Michelle. And then we just got the latest winner, who is Jessica. And we just took her DNA test. And giving these connections back, I've seen such a transformation, and this, she's very interested in this too. It's part of a whole transformation. So she's now gotten this real, like, super stable, super loving and relationship. And she's now one of the most beautiful things I heard, because when I started this program, I definitely wanted her to, I wanted her to get a name. Like, pick an African name. But I just realized when I said that, like, I can't make you pick an African name. This is your transformation. This is your story. So that was in 2018. So this year, when we were getting the new winner in for 2020, she now came to me and said, I know what I'm going to do. And what she's doing, when she gets married, she's going to change her last name to her husband's name, which, I mean, that's fantastic, because now she's getting married and turning into a bond. But she's also going to change her first name. So she's going to be a completely new butterfly. You know what I'm saying? And she's going to have an African first name and her, you know, her name. So it's going to be a completely new person, and she's gearing up and learning the knowledge to get to that point. It's a, you know, and so, you know, that is kind of what, and this program, the African Heritage Diet, is also part of her combined reconnection. So I really want people to, if any, you take anything away from this this presentation, is that there's a lot more missing than just economic opportunity. And, you know, when you think about African-Americans and the things that are going on in our communities, some of these things have already been solved by culture, but because these things are not present in our experience here in the United States, then there are certain things. So we're just gonna naturally not eat as healthy because we don't have our cultural recipes that normally every other, you know, we're supposed to have. So that's the one thing I want you to take away, that there's a big cultural piece that could fix a lot of the issues that we consider to be African-American problems, just by ensuring that we're re-exposing our cultures and mixing our cultures together, forming an Afro-American culture. So, I mean, we still have about 15 minutes. If there's any questions more, we're here. I'm gonna be here. These questions are great. So, do you have anything to say, Sarah? Any extra closing stuff, or I put you on the spot? I know you're in.
That's fine. Yeah. No. If you have any questions about the program, welcome you to visit our website, and my email is also on the resource page, so you can find it there. Shoot me along an email, and I'll get back to you within a day. But I just think it's really great to, try out some recipes, explore, and learn more about just your general cultural heritage, because it's such a connecting and like great experience for the self. You know, it's almost like a self-healing. So I definitely recommend it. And also, I know Marlon was talking about the lady who changes her name. You don't need to be married to do that. You can definitely, go through your own self journey, and that is perfectly fine. I think, yeah, if you ever have any questions, there's our website, and then we have so many resources on there. And please like and subscribe our social media pages. We have our own African Heritage group, but then Marlon also has an awesome Facebook group that I recommend you guys looking into. And I'm here whenever. So thank you.
Thank you so much. I know, but okay. And I wanted to say one thing about that was her journey. That's why I was just explaining her journey. Everybody's got a different journey. I'm not going to tell you anybody's journey. That's what she told me. That's what I told y'all. Uh-huh. So let's see, anything else? So tomorrow, guys, if you go to the resource page, I have a couple of events tomorrow. One is extremely important. One is I teach also about webinars and how to do webinars. So if you like what you saw today and you think you want to pick up something, it's free. Go to our Eventbrite page, or go to our website, hit the event button. You'll find it there. It's also in the resource page. But the most important one is, of course, the big story that's going on today. In fact, we just crossed as a country to a quarter of a million deaths in COVID-19. So tomorrow I'm having a webinar, and we're doing contact tracing awareness. We're adding to the mantra and using our cultural competency aspects of our programming to try and reach communities of color, African diaspora, culture. So if you have anybody that maybe knows a language like Haitian or Cajun Creole, Cape Verdean Creole or Spanish, please let them reach out to me, because we may need some people to help us out, translate some of our COVID-19 awareness program. And basically I'll just give you a short spell in case you can't make it tomorrow at 1 o'clock. just wash your hands, right? Wear a mask, socially distance. But more importantly, we need you also have you contact trace. And what kind, it sounds like a big scary word. All it means is that for the last 2 or 3 days, you need to find a way to remember, write it down, come up with some sort of system in your phone to remember all the contacts you've been around for the past 2 or 3 days. That's really all the program is about. We're trying to limit the exposure of infectious people. So if I find out that I have symptoms today, I need to be able to remember or have some sort of reference point to remember the people that I've been in contact for the past 2-3 days. And if I can contact them and get their information to them, that might save a life. So that, remember, wash your hands, wear a mask, socially distance. Don't be inside, don't be indoors as much as possible, you know, and also finally contact trace. So tomorrow, 1 o'clock, we're doing that webinar. Stay safe, y'all. It's crazy out there. It's about to get crazy. So please, everybody, stay safe. Wear a mask. All right. If there's anything else, let's see if there's anything else, and then we can close up. I just don't want anybody to have questions and we not get to it. Okay, thank you, Victoria. She says she lives in upstate New York. She'll refer this program to another. Thank you. I love the presentation. Thank you. Very inspiring. Thank you. Thank you. Duty calls. I must leave you. Okay. All right. Well, have any more questions? How many people we got? 12 people. All right. Well, if we have no more questions, I will be leaving you guys now. All right. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Have a great day. Night. See you tomorrow, hopefully. Bye.